The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
This morning we are celebrating the fourth Sunday after Pentecost. And today we are going to hear about Jesus calling some more disciples and some people that want to be Jesus' disciples. And we're going to find out that maybe they have a snag or two as they come along to follow Jesus. Welcome to all the visitors that are here this morning. We are glad that you are able to worship with you. And we pray that you are blessed as you gather together with us around Christ and His Word. We begin with the first hymn. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept the record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, and to call upon Him in prayer and praise, let us first consider our unworthiness, and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The heavens declare the glory of God.
And the sky above proclaims his handiwork.
Day to day pours out speech.
And night to night reveals knowledge.
Their measuring line goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world.
In them they have set a tent for the sun.
Which comes out like a bridegroom leaving his chamber.
And like a strong man runs its course with joy.
Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them. And there is nothing hidden from us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen.
The heavens declare the glory of God.
And the sky above proclaims his handiwork.
Son, Jesus Christ, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that following his steps, we may steadfastly walk in the way that leads to eternal life. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And the Old Testament reading is from 1 Kings, the 19th chapter. Behold, the word of the Lord came to Elijah. And he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts. For the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left. And they seek my life to take it away." And he said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord." And behold, the Lord passed by, And a great and strong wind tore the mountain and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left. And they seek my life to take it away." And the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. And Jehu, the son of Nimshi, you shall anoint to be king over Israel. And Elijah, the son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, you shall anoint to be prophet in your place. And the one who escapes from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu put to death. And the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha put to death. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." So he departed from there, and found Elisha the son of Shaphat, and who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen in front of him, and he was with the 12. Elijah passed by him and cast his cloak upon him, and he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, "Let me kiss my father and my mother, then I will follow you." And he said to him, "Go back again. What have I done to you?" And he returned from following him and took the yoke of oxen and sacrificed them and boiled their flesh with the yokes of the oxen and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he arose and went after Elijah and assisted him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And the epistle reading is from Galatians, the 5th chapter. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealous, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia.
Gospel according to St. Luke, the 9th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the days drew near for Jesus to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he sent messengers ahead of him, who went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make preparations for him. But the people did not receive him, because his face was set toward Jerusalem. And when his disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to tell fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them, and they went on to another village. And as they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." And Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Yet another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home." Jesus said to him, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I believe in God,
the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and he sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated, and we sing the next hymn.
Thank you.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem when he ran into a few discipleship snags. Now, a discipleship snag is when someone is following Jesus or wants to follow Jesus, but they have something wrong in what it means to follow Jesus. And in our reading today, we're going to find out that Jesus runs into four discipleship snags. And we need to hear about these discipleship snags because chances are we probably have these same snags in us as well. Now, I say that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem, but our reading from Luke actually says it much stronger. It says he has his face set to go to Jerusalem. That is, he has his face set to go to the place of the cross, to the place of salvation. He has his face set to go to the place where he will lay down his life for the world, including you. And on his way to Jerusalem, he decides to carry out ministry in Samaria. He wants to proclaim the good news of his presence, bring the good news of healing, bring all the good news that he could ever bring by his being among them. But the Samaritans reject him. The Samaritans reject him because they're just a little bit different country, and they reject most Jews on the way to Jerusalem. They reject him because they claim they have their own God, their own temple. They reject him because they do not believe that he is the Messiah and Savior. And they reject him because they do not think that they need his good news. So they reject him. And this is where Jesus hits his first discipleship snag. And it's unexpected, at least from our point of view, because it's in James and John, two of the first disciples that were ever called. They literally left their father sitting in the boat when Jesus walked along the shores and said, "Follow me." And they did. They followed him, and they witnessed such things as Jesus casting out a legion of unclean spirits. They witnessed with their own eyes Jesus raising someone from the dead. They assisted in the feeding of the 5,000. They witnessed Jesus forgiving great sinners, well-known sinners. They just recently had seen all the glory of Jesus shining through him on the Mount of Transfiguration. And they had 2.5 years of teaching that they learned from Jesus. They trusted in him. They followed him. They believed in him. They could not believe that anyone would ever reject him. And here's part of the discipleship snag. They thought that anyone who rejected Jesus deserved divine punishment right now. So much so that they said to Jesus, "Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven and consume them?" No patience, no prayer, no preaching. Fire. Consume them right now. Do you have this discipleship snag, or have you ever had this discipleship snag? Jesus called you to follow him through the word, through your baptism, and you have. You have probably followed him, many of you, longer than 2.5 years. And you have witnessed Jesus forgive well-known sinners. And maybe you are even the well-known sinner that he has forgiven. And you have taken hope in his life at the death of someone you love. You daily rise with him in your baptism. You commune with him at his table. And you follow him so much so that you actually look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. And so, you can't believe that others reject him. But they do. They reject him in different parts of your life. There's those who are the politicians, those in politics, reject him. You run into those on Facebook and other social media that outright reject him. Then it gets a little closer to home, people in our community. It gets a little more closer to home, people in our own family. They reject him. And have you ever gotten to the point where you just run out of patience? It's not in our nature, really, to say, send down fire from heaven and consume them. But maybe they deserve that tornado in that town. Maybe they deserve that earthquake for rejecting Jesus. Well, Jesus chops down that snag by rebuking James and John and rebuking us. See, his mission is not a mission of vengeance and fire, but his mission is a mission of mercy and compassion and patience. He rebukes us. And in that rebuke, there's a little reminder to pray for those in our lives who reject Jesus. Pray for the enemies of the church. Pray for those in our country and world who reject Jesus. Pray for them because we follow Jesus, and we follow Jesus who was rejected by the Samaritans and yet had patience. And that's good news for us because that means? That Jesus has patience even with us and for us. With Jesus, he moves on to the next town, and as he moves on to the next town, there's a large crowd that's following him. Think about the 5,000, how many are following him, all these kinds of people, huge crowd, and a would-be disciple comes up and runs up to him and says, Jesus, I will follow you wherever you go. But here is discipleship's snag. He thinks that following Jesus is popular and cool. Everyone is following Jesus, it seems. And this would-be disciple has gotten caught up in the excitement and popular thing that this is the thing you got to be doing. So he'll follow Jesus as long as it's popular. It happens, right? I'll follow Jesus as long as the church is popular. I'll follow Jesus as long as this church is popular. I'll follow Jesus if it brings me some cool factor, if it brings me some prestige, if it brings me some prosperity. I'll follow Jesus as long as it's the trendy thing to do. But Jesus eradicates that snag too. He says his way is not the easy way. He says the foxes have their holes, the birds of the air have their nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Jesus is telling everyone who's caught up in the moment, you want to follow me? Prepare yourself to be uncomfortable. Prepare yourself for sleepless nights. Prepare yourself to follow a rejected leader. Was that would-be disciple up for that? Don't know. Bigger question is, are we up for that? Following him even when it's difficult, uncomfortable, and sleepless? Jesus continues down the road, and he sees another man, and he says to this man, follow me. But the man answered, first, let me go and bury my father. Now, this doesn't seem initially like much of a snag because we might think that his father is dead. But it doesn't seem like his father is dead. Otherwise, why isn't he making funeral preparations? And why isn't he at the funeral? His Father is very much alive. And who knows when his Father will die. Our lives are in the Lord's time. Would it be at the end of the year? Would it be 5 years, 10 years, 20 years? And then he would go and follow Jesus? It's procrastinating. And so Jesus says to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead. You follow me." No, he said, "You go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Have you ever found yourself saying, "I'll follow Jesus a little bit later on"? That procrastination snag. "I'll follow Jesus after I get married. I'll follow Jesus after I have kids. I'll follow Jesus after my kids get a little bit older. I'll follow Jesus when it fits into my life a little bit better. I'll follow Jesus later." Jesus says, "Let the dead bury their own dead." See, Jesus is not worried about the dead. He's going to die for them, die their death. He's going to rise again. "Let the dead bury the dead." He'll take care of the dead. But it's for you, you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. That's right. Proclaim the kingdom of God. I'll do it for us. On behalf of all of you today, I'll do it today. The kingdom of God is in your midst. This kingdom right here, the church, this is where Jesus is ruling with forgiveness and life and mercy. No waiting for it. It is here together as we gather two or three in his name. In this kingdom, sins are forgiven. Death is destroyed. Life reigns in Jesus. And we wait to be raised from the grave, renewed and refreshed. The kingdom is in our midst right now. Trust it, believe it, it's for you. And then as you're able in your vocation, proclaim it, preach it. While Jesus was on the road, another man runs up and says to him, "Lord, I will follow you, but first let me go and say farewell to those at home." Well, you say, not much of a snag there either, because what's the harm in saying goodbye? I'm going to follow Jesus for a while. Well, the discipleship snag really here is, he's not going home to say goodbye, but, "Mom and Dad, do you mind if I go and follow Jesus?" He's asking, going to go home and ask permission to follow Jesus. And what do you think his family will say? Well, maybe. No? Yes? Who knows what the family will say? But if he does, even if they say yes, he's always going to have this divided loyalty where they might just say, "It's time for you to come back from following Jesus. We got things to do at home. We got things to do in the farm, business, whatever it may be." It was divided loyalty. And he was letting his family have a greater say in following Jesus than Jesus. And so since he has this divided loyalty, he says, that's a snag. He says to this man, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of heaven." You know why? Because you plow like this. Looks back. You keep one hand, always keep one hand on the plow. And you look back like this. It's divided loyalty. One going this way, one going that way. In following Jesus, you can't look back. It's hold on to the plow. Both hands. It's all or nothing with Jesus. There are no compromises, no divided loyalties. If you keep looking back when you plow, you're going to have a crooked furrow. It's all Jesus. So don't look back. Hold on. Hold on to Jesus. Hold on to him because he is your only salvation. Hold on to him because he's the only one that makes us disciples. Hold on to him. Because it's not going to be easy to be a disciple. Hold on to Jesus because he is the one who held on to the crowd, held on to the cross for you. Hold on. Hold on to Jesus because he puts his kingdom right here in our midst to give us life and forgiveness. Hold on to Jesus because when it came to saving you, he never looked back. In Jesus' name. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, your Son has found us, and he calls to us, follow me. And by that powerful, creative call, we have followed him. But you know that as we follow him, we have all these discipleship snags. We sometimes want to destroy the enemies of the church instead of patiently praying for them, proclaiming to them. Sometimes we want to procrastinate in our following him. And sometimes we have divided loyalties. And there are some snags of which we are even unaware. So we pray, grant us your Holy Spirit through your word and sacraments, so that no matter what comes our way, that we would follow Jesus and hold on to him, and help us to always know that he had his face set on Jerusalem, the place of the cross, for us and for our salvation. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for the enemies of the church. Turn their hearts to your Son, crucified and risen for them. And as we encounter these enemies of the church, help us to be kind to them, to forgive them, and to show them mercy. Lord, in your mercy. On this Independence Day weekend, we thank you for our nation. We thank you that we have the freedom to worship you in peace. And we pray that that right would always remain. We thank you for those who have given their lives that we might be free. We thank you for those who are serving right now to preserve that freedom. Be with them, help them, support them. We pray for our leaders. Grant them wisdom and a desire to do what is best for the people of our country and state. And we commend our leaders, our people, and our country into your hands. Lord, in your mercy. We thank you for the young people of this congregation. We pray that you be with those and that are going to travel to the National Youth Gathering this week. May their travels be safe, and may they be strengthened in faith as they gather together with young people of the same faith, and may they end as they hear your word together. We commend them and Jackie into your care. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all those who are in need of healing. We especially pray for Dee Youngblood. Be with her as she struggles to breathe. Grant her hope as she receives hospice care that there is life in Jesus. Be with Bob and the rest of her family. Grant them comfort in Jesus, who is the resurrection and the life. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all those who are gathered together in this place and all members of Bethesda Lutheran Church. Strengthen us that we may hold firm the hope that we have in Christ. We especially thank you for and pray for Everett LaMountain and Ben, Andrea, Gina, and Connor Kramer. Bless them, sustain them in faith, and we commend them and all those gathered here into your hands. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the businesses and industries of this town, community, and surrounding areas. We especially pray for those who are affected by construction. Bless them, that they may flourish according to your will. We thank you for the rain that we've been having. We pray for good and seasonable weather, that the crops may continue to grow, and that there may be a bountiful harvest according to your will. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you in favor and give you peace.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's been a pleasure to share God's word with you this morning. Before we begin with the announcements, we have a birthday we have to recognize today. Carrie Fisher has a birthday later this week. And
so does Uncle John.
Oh, wow.
This is the night.
It didn't get in her stuff. So happy birthday as well. So let us sing happy birthday. And God's blessings to John, God's blessings to Carrie this week as you celebrate your birthday. And any anniversaries? All right, nobody got married on the week of the 4th. This week, you heard me pray for our young people. This week, Isaiah, are you going to the National Youth Gathering? Yep. Isaiah's going to the National Youth Gathering. The other youth from our congregation are going down to Houston, Texas. And the youth gathering, there's like 20,000 kids, right? And so all these kids are heading down to Houston later on this week. And so remember them, and hopefully Jack will send a few pictures here and there, and we'll be able to see them. But remember them, keep them in your prayers this week. This week, also tomorrow, there are going to be two floats. One is going to be Right to Life is going to have a float in the parade, and Bethesda Lutheran School is going to have a float in the parade. And they're going to be handing out stuff about art, and they're going to be painting, and it's a little bit of preparation because there's going to be a big fundraiser in September. And so look for that. There's going to be a silent auction. That's in September. But tomorrow, look for the float and the platform and whatever. So, are there any other? Marianne.
Hi, I had heard about a few people that were really hurt by the hail, so we're doing a help for the hail at the Dakota Bar on next Saturday. If you want to have buy lunch over there between 9:30 and 2, that'd be awesome. And also, we're starting a new study on Friday. We'll be doing the non-colleague letters, so we'll start with Jane.
All right.
Please come.
Start with what?
James.
All right, start with James. All right, Friday.
There is a note in your bulletin, but just a reminder that we do have our Hot Springs Area Right to Life meeting on Thursday. If you're in the overflow room and you're all invited, you should join us.
It's July, and we won't hurt you already.
Pastor, we have a former daughter of the congregation here this morning, and what was your dad's name?
Martin
Liddell. Martin Liddell. Everybody remember Pastor Liddell?
Yes.
Yeah, Pastor Liddell's daughter is here today, and so. And so, welcome back. Good to have you here today. And I'm going on vacation after worship next Sunday. And if you are in need of pastoral care, please call Pastor Mundo. I'll get a phone number in the bulletin this coming week. And I'll put it on our Facebook as well, our private Facebook page as well, so that you can give him a call if you need pastoral care while I am gone. You are all invited down the way. And for some coffee and some refreshments today. So hope you stop by and have that today. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and a blessed Independence Day tomorrow as well, as we celebrate the freedom that we have in this country to worship our Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all this week.